I guess we maybe just kick it off. So let's see. Sunday morning, pretty early. We might have some few arrivals trickling in, so with the assistance can just ensure that it goes smoothly. This is the artificial intelligence revolution presentation by Kai Singh. So I got to learn that his background is in from Lazada. He went to Dublin High. And that's not quite a bit to share on machine learning and effectively his data science approach. So this is going to run for about 25 minutes. Mm-hmm. And we're going to be recording the session. So, Kai Singh, up to you.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, so thank you all for coming today on a Sunday morning. Yeah, oh, this is a bit loud. I'll try to talk softer. So today we're going to talk about AI evolution. And part of the whole point is because there's a lot of talks that we have been to, let me stand back a bit, that focus a lot on the mathematics and the coding. But there is very few that actually focus a lot on the logic and the thinking process behind AI. And the thing is, I've been doing like machine learning and recommendation systems for a couple of years. And basically, I feel that anything that can glorified lookup tables, where we basically pre-generate a lot of the recommendations, a lot of the relationships between people. There is no intelligence in it. The model is kind of just looking up whatever we generated beforehand. And why today's talk will focus a lot on reinforcement learning is because reinforcement learning is the closest thing we have to at least what we have seen in movies, where we actually have models that think. Models that can learn. I think I need to deal with the mic. The feedback is pretty bad, sorry. Yeah. Okay. Okay, so we're doing models we've learned, right? So what we want is to Testing. Can I just shout? I mean, it's a small crowd, right? But I think the mic. Yeah, let me see.
Maybe without the mic.
Yeah, we'll do the mic. Can you hear me? Yeah, okay, that's much better. Okay, finally, okay, let's talk about reinforcement learning. Okay, so today's technical talk will focus on the game playing in OpenAI Gym. So you can see there are two games here. On the left is my implementation of Q-learning, blah, 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 experience replay. We'll go through some of these concepts later. And on the right is A3C. So one thing you need to learn about all this is the environment keep changing. There is no physics. So when I share about the rocket landing, people ask, is there physics or is there information provided? There isn't. So the agent will learn to play the game based on the reward feedback. So all we are telling the agent is that if you land, you crash, you minus point, you land between the flag. We don't even tell them the flag concept. Just say land somewhere in the area will give them different very amount of rewards based on how close they are. So think of it as a feedback system. We don't explicitly train the model for any particular scenarios. We just give them a feedback that if you do this, you get that reward. And that's the foundation of reinforcement learning. Similarly for that, you see the entire map is generated randomly. So the agent won't know if there's a block coming soon or there's a hole in the ground. You'll scan the environment and try to react and walk as best as it can. That's actually a very difficult problem. There's like very few people that actually managed to solve it until H3C came out, and we'll talk more about that later. So I want to dive a bit to the sidetrack, the philosophical side of it. So when you see the training thing, right, there is always an exploitation cycle. So initially, you can see there's a lot of negative score. So how to read this is when there's a whole bunch of negative score, basically the rocket in this case is crashing all the time, it's figuring out the world. Because like we said, we train it from a blank state. Think of it as like baby that just got started. Basically, it's just bumping around and trying all sorts of random things. Where's that kind of random things. And I call it the so cute and so dumb stage. Basically, you just see that it's doing really stupid things.
Check, hey.
Yeah. But eventually, you'll start exploiting the knowledge once you build up sufficient understanding of the environment. And that's where you see the cutoff, the tipping point, where we start exploiting the environment and it shoots up. So basically it's learning, it has learned enough about the environment to start executing on what it knows. So you want to land as smoothly as possible in between the two flags. It figure out by itself. We never tell him that. And eventually you reach beyond human level. So you can actually play the game yourself. And it's very hard because the rocket just starts in some random state and you need to play the left thruster, right thruster, main thruster, and then you start spinning around and start crashing, even as a human. But machines, once you reach beyond human level, it never forgets. So it's kind of like you go through many generations of learning and eventually it builds up to the capability of where humans can never be as stable in performance as a robot. We'll get tired, we'll be like, we won't be able to focus all the time, but machines never do. And so Wade Bawai has an article about the AI revolution. And the thing is, initially when we are looking at AI as a state where it's like stupider than an ant. So I have a friend here that tell me, I asked him about RL and current state of AI. He says, Raymond says that it's stupider than most insects, which I agree. I mean, insects have their own kind of intelligence and the way they work ants, for example, building structures and stuff. The current state of AI is really stupid. It's very far away. But once it reached the stage beyond the very cute and stupid stage where it starts exploiting the knowledge, and once the first human equivalent AI is invented, it takes a very short time for them to train itself to reach Albert Einstein level. And once you have a room of Albert Einstein, millions of them teaching each other mathematics, teaching each other about the world, it takes a very short time for them to exceed everything that human can come up with and go far beyond that. And that's what this article is about. And that's basically what some of the fears of superintelligence will come into play. Having said that, like I said, we are very far away. We are at this starting stage of N, not even N level yet. So we are very far away. So let's start from the basic one, why play games? So today's thing we'll talk about games. And games are good because it's fun. You can see the rockets, whatever, people get excited. And at the same time, it's a very kind of contained problem. You don't have a lot of like extra outside factors affecting it. We can kind of like have a simulated environment and we just play well inside it. But the complaint, of course, is it's not generalizable. You play one game, the things are useless to bring across. And that is true in terms of the raw code. It's not true in terms of the thinking behind the raw code. And a lot of things we share today comes from the AlphaGo, the team that actually played Go, and we are transferring all these things into other domains because of their improvement for the agent over time. So the knowledge, the thinking can be transferable, and that's what we should focus on today. So OpenAI is Elon Musk and gang that started this environment. To understand the importance of this, before that, people that do RL and AI spend a lot of time generating like environments to test. So actually, we spend a lot more time building all these things before we even start running the models. So that's a waste of a lot of effort. It takes days or weeks, depends on how complex your environment is. Now they have Atari games, they have like robotics game, they have 3D games. That it gives you a very simple start. Look at this, it's like 6 lines of code. What's happening now is I'm just telling you to take 1,000 random actions. It's supposed to balance the pole, but because the actions are all random, it's just spinning around. But it's not hard. I mean, like anyone who can write Python can just import the gym and then start coding straight away. I mean, the more complex environment, of course, there are various stages, but it's not hard. I mean, most people can learn it within half a day. And even if you're not interested in coding, there's a whole bunch of resources on the OpenAI where they talk about the latest development in AI and the environment. So this is useful still as kind of read up and understand the industry better. So let's talk about the simple zombie game. So you live in a terrible world where the only gift in life is ice cream. And you drive through hordes of zombies to get your gift in life, ice cream. And obviously, if you drive in them, you get eaten. So it's a bad idea. So the simplest thing you can come up with, a 4-square, okay? So there's a zombie on the left. You can't go diagonal, okay? So that's the thing. You can't go diagonal, you can go like 4 directions. And you go forward, there's nothing. You go like your goal is to reach the ice cream. So you can see there are already various states, action and reward. So you have a start state, your initial location. Action, you can go forward, down you crash into the wall, right you crash into the wall, left you crash into the zombie. And there are various rewards. So driving upwards seems to give you the best reward, and left you get eaten. So what will you do? Class, what will you do? Yeah, drive in a zombie. Yeah. No, you go forward, okay? You move forward. Yeah, I mean, you can feed a zombie, you're charitable or something. So a logical agent. So a logical maximizing agent will drive forward because to maximize long-term reward. We'll talk about long-term and short-term later. So we want to maximize long-term reward, we drive forward. So now we have ice cream on the left, give us a good score. We can drive backwards, it's a positive score. I mean, you're not losing much. You can just crash in the walls and get nothing. So a logical agent, again, will maximize the reward and just drive into the ice cream. And that's all you need to know about the fundamentals of reinforcement learning. And to be more precise, so as a bunch of equations, whatever, scary stuff, but it's the same thing. You look at it closely, it's same thing, state, action, reward. So this will, in the Q-learning environment, we'll talk about beyond that later, it's always state, action, reward, in all sorts of combination. So in this case, the Bellman's equation, the most basic of all, state, action, reward, where we actually have like a learning rate, we make transfer into a Q-learning equation, and we'll go through the code later. It's a loop, but basically you want to maximize the long-term reward. You take the new action, whatever the value you have is the old action, plus the learning rate times the information gain. Code-wise, it looks like this. So it's literal translation of the equation. It's a loop, and we have a state, action, state, action, state, action, and we have alpha and gamma, basically to adjust the learning rate and how much decay we apply onto the future reward, and it take the max of the state and actions. So it's a literal translation, and the code itself isn't super complicated. It's more like the thinking. So it's a recursive calculation. What this means is we are going around, let's say, 1,000 times around these four squares over and over again until the entire thing completes. So there are different ways of ending it. Either it's stabilized, or after 1,000 loops, we figure out, okay, after 1,000 loops, what's the total score of each square? So obviously, the ice cream square will be the highest, and the zombie square will have the lowest, and then we can use that to decide to get the initial reward, to get this score right here. So that's a very stupid way of doing things, because you basically have to do it thousand and thousand times, and if the space is very big, you just loop through everything. It's extremely stupid, which is why we have other techniques that come to play. So I'll go through them over the rest of the time, and you can see all these papers are released by AlphaGo people to kind of like, not just them, I mean, it's a combination of a lot of smart people. But over time, we build up this knowledge of what we have today. Okay, so I mean, the last few years, all this Go and AlphaGo thing, and one of the things that they say a lot is that the state space, the possibility of games is more than a galaxy of stars and so on. So that taking it as a hyperbole, not how many stars are there in the galaxy, taking away the science part, the fact still stands. You cannot do the whatever you just did and loop through every combination on Earth over and over again because it's not scalable. Your one query will probably take a long time, or even training it will take years. So instead, there's a thing called functional approximation. So we change it to a supervised learning problem that we're very familiar with. We want to have the best approximation for the loss function. Basically, using what, as the agent move around, like just now we drive around the map, we build up an understanding of the map. And can we use that to kind of approximate what will happen if we move into spaces we have never explored? So that's the main idea. And where all this comes in is the bottom part. Basically, the model maximization is the typical thing that we have for the loss function. You can use, in this case, I use momentum, you can use gradient descent or whatever. So it's a very familiar concept for machine learning people. And machine learning people love throwing neural networks and stuff. In this case, you can use a simple neural network, you can use deep learning, whatever fancy thing. So this is the machine learning part. Basically, you just treat it as a sub-machine learning problem in your reinforcement learning. So that's how they help each other. Now, but even if you treat it as a machine learning problem, they come back to the point of exploration, exploitation. Because reinforcement learning is not just simple supervised learning or unsupervised learning methods. You need to be able to have a tipping point where you tell it to stop trying random things. Initially, it will be just randomly exploring to build up the knowledge. Then you can use your supervised learning neural networks to play with it. But how do you say when do we swap over to start exploiting your knowledge? So that's where we use the idea called epsilon. So from simulated annealing or from supervised learning methods, we learn this a lot. where we have a decay factor. And initially, we set very high, just doing random actions. After a while, the factor decays, and we do less and less random action. So imagine at the start it's 100% random, maybe at the end it's like 5%, 1%, 0% random. It's full exploitation mode. And yeah, in this case, I use some base net or whatever, but the main thing is the temperature and the chance or whatever. So basically, we're using that as epsilon to change over time as the loop goes by. So again, it's not like groundbreaking concept or groundbreaking code. It's bringing the concepts together. And building on top of that, we start talking about, once we have that, we can have a function approximation to deal with the space. We can have epsilon to decay over time. Now we talk about long-term versus short-term optimization. So this idea is very good and very powerful because when we look at, for example, the ice cream game, let's say the zombies move, because zombies tend to roar. Let's say you're driving on ice, your car is not 100% steering the same direction. Sometimes you skid, you move too far forward. Sometimes you skid to the wrong direction. Is it to your long-term benefit in that case to always take a shortest path? The shortest path in this case, you notice, is in between two zombies. What if they happen to randomly stumble into you and eat you up? So in the short term, we call it, there's a value function, whereas the long term, and short term is called advantage. If we want to optimize the value, the long-term survival, the long-term ice cream eating, we might want to drive around them, even if the short-term goal is bad. You may take a lot more moves to reach the ice cream, but it's a lot safer in the long run, assuming you're going to like eat ice cream for next like hundreds of days or years or whatever. So that's the concept behind it, dualing. And again, code is simple. You literally split it into two networks, optimize it, and add it up at the end. It's not like rocket science. But it's more like this concept of dualing allows us to think about what if we break apart the problem into long-term, short-term, and what if we break apart the problem into more layers? Why do we stop at two? So in this case, we start thinking about the concept of like multiple layers of things and letting each layer do kind of like different optimization. And that's where we start talking about separate targeting network, double queue network. So from this part onwards, it gets less and less, I would say, obvious. The previous things are pretty obvious and straightforward. So from here onwards, you get more into like some of the conceptual things where people start thinking deeper, like what humans do. Humans don't think of it, don't optimize a problem just on one reward function. We break it up into components before we arrive at a decision. So this is what it's trying to do, is similar, have multiple networks doing different things. So in this case, we talk about like separate targeting network, storage arrays, blah, 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 and double queue network. Let's make it simple. So what I was trying to say is, instead of just having a single network that basically decides what we do and decides what reward we get from it, let's break it up. And the reason being is the feedback loop. Similar to what happened in the mic just now, if I talk into the mic and the mic goes back in and it amplifies my voice and I talk to the mic, it goes in the feedback loop continuously. If I train a model on the data and I use the data from the model to train the model and I do it 1,000 times, 1,000,000 times, it creates a kind of like a self-fulfilling prophecy. It just keeps going itself, keep generating data to feed itself. And you have very huge danger of going to local optimal solutions. So we need to break it apart such that we introduce, in this case, the separate targeting network is trying to say we introduce noise on purpose. So it's unintuitive for machine. I mean, for machine learning, we use like kind of like break it up into like various training sets and stuff. In that sense, it's similar. So we introduce noise. We purposely use a separate targeting network and we don't use all the data. We purposely have two queue networks, in this case, one to train the data and one to train on the value, the reward on the data. And then we merge it back together. And then it brings to the next concept of deep learning. So breaking up convolution cycles. And in this case, we are talking about the computer vision part of it, where we use pixels, where we use like many other attributes to bring in, to merge together. So all these are resources. I'm just giving you the gist of the thinking behind it. So all this, you can click on the resources. We'll share the slides later, and you can check it out more. And the code looks like this. So it starts to get a bit more interesting from a programming perspective. So in this case, I'm using a base network. I drop some of the random nodes randomly to create noise. I have the two queue network that call each other. I have gamma. it's a simple thing where we basically we're breaking apart the problem into many layers and they're calling each other. So I mean, you can digest it later. But moving on beyond, so all that is kind of the old school way of doing reinforcement learning. So again, this is a course that will probably take like a semester to go through, so I'm condensing it a lot. Now we are talking about A3C, which is moving beyond Q-learning, and it's probably last 2 years of work from the AlphaGo guys that has huge, basically just changed the whole industry. Before that, all this Q-learning thing was cool, but it was not scalable because we are just having one agent, it's very cute, and we train it over time. A3C is like MapReduce, so for people into like Hadoop, into parallelism, big data and stuff, think of it as having a puppet master with many puppets below, each puppet doing their own thing, and the puppet master coordinates the effort. So this makes it scalable to the infinity in some sense. As long as you have the hardware, you can run billions of various kind of training, and then a puppet master to coordinate everything. It sounds simple in theory, but combining it is extremely hard. That's the hardest part of the A3C, to be able to combine it in a logical way and to build up the knowledge over time. And so there are, of course, three parts to A3C. Asynchronous, so we train each environment. So think of it as just now we have one rocket. So we have a million rockets, independent, asynchronously running by itself. And then there's actor, critic. Actor critic is the puppet master. So the actors, all the puppets, will give feedback to the critic. The critic will talk, say, this is a terrible idea. You're stupid. Learn from the other guy. Try this thing. Try that thing. So over time, the critic will tell the actors to come to a possible conclusion. Maybe yes, maybe not. Depends on how you build it. And basically to optimize their reward based on from the grand perspective of a puppet master. Advantage came from dualing. So just now we're talking about advantage, short-term gains. So in this case, the critic will take care of the long-term. Everyone else take care of the short-term. You just want to optimize for a little environment, get your ice cream. The puppet master will take care of the zombies and randomness and whatever other problems. So that's the gist of it. There's a code and that explanation up there. But is there an easier way? So I was talking about this, I mean, we just went through the entire kind of revolution over the past, reinforcement learning has been like probably 20 years. The past 5 years has been super exciting. So a lot of things you see is past 5 years. Keras, RL, I will talk about just now, deep learning, double QQN, dualing, A3C, it's all that. So you can just call a library. Again, the whole point of me being here is to tell you, don't be a code monkey. Don't just call a library and, A3C, yay, and then just fill up the blanks. No, you need to understand the power and the reason why it works and a lot of the theories behind it, or dualing. And the best way is to combine some of these concepts together, which is quite hard. Because H3C by itself is a pain to optimize and code up. You need to combine the rest, it's difficult. But that's where the understanding of the logic will come in helpful. Tensorflow RL as well. So all these are libraries that are in development, and this is less kind of like there are less activity in it, but it still has most of the things that we need. And so the fun thing now is H3C with GPU clusters, and NVIDIA Labs have the entire project on H3C with GPU. If you want to, NVIDIA nowadays have the cloud-based NVIDIA GPU as well. You can always spin up AWS to do the same thing. Then it's LSTM, basically all the deep learning stuff, GPU, you want to play Super Mario Bros, you can contribute to the Super Mario Bros project. So all these are available out there. At the end of the day is the famous call, if not now, when? And the reason being, now is there are a lot of tools out there that can help you. It's no longer like 20 years ago where all these are conceptual. There's an environment, OpenAI, for you to play with. There are libraries for you to call, and there are a lot of papers for you to read if you need the mathematics and understanding. And even then, there are also a lot of support in forums and stuff. It's probably the best time, AWS, hardware. There is no longer an excuse for us not to kind of like try it out at home, just try it for a bit, at least understand what this thing is. It's like we went through the slide, it's understandable, at least at a basic level. You want to go deeper, of course, it's a lot harder. So I mean, it's the best time to be alive, to try out AI on your own laptop, spin up a cluster, and play with all this technology. And with that, I'd like to end my talk. Thank you so much for coming on a Sunday morning. Thank you. Yeah, we've got time for questions. Yes, question.
Any questions?
Yes, yes.
Are you doing this on your local PC or do you do it in the cloud?
It's the same thing. So I do it on my local PC, but the reason being is more like I'm a cheapo, and also it doesn't matter, in all honesty. Okay, doesn't matter until you touch this part. This part obviously matters. Because Mac being stupid, the GPU is useless. So obviously, when you do this part, you need the cluster. If not, everything else above can do in a local PC, like even for this. Again, it depends on the challenge you're taking. So for the rocket, it's considered simple, medium. Let's say you want to do the running thing. Running thing is, there's a version of it, there's a hardcore version. There's a soft core and a hardcore. The hardcore version, you need a cluster. Because it's what's so difficult about it? Completely random and unlimited. I think the soft core one, it ends after some time. This thing will just keep running. It's a dungeon, endless dungeon with unlimited thing. There's also Flappy Bird and all the more difficult games you can play. So those need cluster. Yeah. Yes. Okay, so that's an interesting question. Like, I think the closest thing we talked about it was when I was still in Lazada. So I was talking with some of the friends there, and we talked about using reinforcement learning in recommendation systems. To answer that clearly is, at this stage, I think RL is fun to play, but I think it's the reward for business is not there. It takes a lot of time to set up. You need to have a very good feedback cycle. So playing games is one thing. You have a very clear feedback cycle. You do this, you can eat ice cream, you get a reward. In the business world, people use it for advertisement. They use it for investment. You click an advertisement, you get a reward. But you can do the same using traditional supervised methods, unsupervised methods, so at a much cheaper pace. So at this point in time, I would say maybe not. Maybe not beyond, not in the commercial space at the moment. In future, maybe we'll see more and more of such things when we really need it. Like even for, let's say we look at e-commerce, I do a lot of recommender, right? So-called stupid methods that's very fast, using graph, using pre-computed relationships, it's good enough. Like, you don't need a full-time reinforcement agent that's very expensive to run, very expensive to maintain and build, to kind of recommend new stuff. You can just pre-compute everything and just cache it with all the hardware and whatever and just pump the result out. So that's really good enough to make a lot of money for the company. So I'll say at the moment, not yet. This for fun and laughter, but maybe give it a few more years, it'll be different. At the moment, we don't have something that's like very suitable for industry.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you so much.